Hey class, today we're going to talk about multi-step equations. We've talked about one-step equations before. We're going to do a quick review over that, and then we're going to dive really into what is a multi-step equation and how to solve it. So to begin with, let's talk about our objective. We're going to be able to solve a variable in a multi-step equation. An example of that would be something like this. First, let's do a quick review over what opposites are. Opposites, when it comes to solving an algebraic problem, are operations that cancel each other out. So for example, if we have 2 plus 2, it's 4. If we then try and take away a 2, we end up with 2. Therefore, adding a 2 and taking a 2 away leave us with the same answer on both sides, the front and the end. That's what makes addition and subtraction opposites. The same can be true of multiplication and division. If you do 7 times 3, you get 21. If you then turn around and divide by that same number, which is 3, you end up with 7. Multiplying by 3 and dividing by 3 cancel each other out. Therefore, they're also considered opposites. And something new we haven't really talked about are exponents, powers, and roots. We're going to kind of get into that a little later. Now, what is the goal when it comes to solving an algebra problem? A lot of students will just dive right into it and not really understand what they should be shooting for, and then they get lost in the process. Your goal is to get the variable by itself. It should say more specifically, your goal is to always get the variable by itself on one side of the equal sign. This means that you have to cancel out all the numbers that are with the variable to get it by itself. So if you had 2x, for example, that 2 is in the way, you'd have to get rid of it. If you had 3x plus 7, both the 3 and the 7 are in the way, so you have to somehow get rid of both of them. We're going to dive more into that a little later, but that's your goal, is to get rid of those. This is important to note that 99% of the time, roughly, a variable looks like a letter. Letter is not a proper term in math. You should probably try to use the word variable, but it could look like something else. It doesn't have to be a letter. And you always take care of what's farthest away first. That will become more clear once we really get into this. Now, addition. To cancel out addition, we have to subtract, just like the 2 plus 2 was 4, and 4 minus 2 was 2. Adding 2 and taking away 2 left us where we started. That's why they're considered opposites. So for example, if we had x plus 4 equals 10, remember our goal is to get that x by itself. There's a number in the way, that 4 right there. Well, it's not just a 4, it's a plus 4. And again, the opposite is subtraction. So you're going to subtract 4 from the plus 4, and it's going to go away and leave the x by itself. But you can't leave it at that, because whatever you do to one side, you do to the other. So 10 minus 4 gives you 6. Now, why do we do that? This equal sign is kind of like a law. Whatever happens on one side has to also happen on the other, hence the equal sign. You can't take away 4 apples on one side and not take away 4 on the other. That equal sign is a law to make sure you do the same thing on both sides. It has to remain equal. Now, what about a positive number? We understand that addition and subtraction are opposites. That makes a lot of sense. But what if it's a positive number we're dealing with? There's a reason that a positive symbol and an addition symbol look exactly the same. Because guess what? They are the same, mathematically speaking. So if we had a problem like this, that's not a negative. That's just a little bullet there. So this is a 9 plus b. I want to get the b by itself, but this 9 is in the way. Now, it's not just a 9, it's a positive 9. Remember, if a number is by itself, it's the same thing as calling that number a positive number. So that 9 is all by itself. So how do we get rid of a positive number? Same thing that we do with addition, we're going to subtract. So if you want a little quick way to remember that, those two are opposites. Whether it's positive negative, addition subtraction, or addition negative, or positive subtraction, they're opposites. So to get rid of that 9, since it's positive, we're going to subtract. So here we are subtracting 9, which makes the 9 go away. But again, this is the law. So what you do to one side, you do to the other side. 12 minus 9 is 3. Now, just like writing the positive sign and not writing it are the same, same thing happens here. That's a positive b. Now there's nothing in front of it. It's positive. We can just get rid of it. It's not needed. So at the end of the day, b is equal to 3. Now we talked about addition, so what about subtraction? The opposite of subtraction is addition, just like the opposite of addition is subtraction. It works both ways. So here we have a minus 7. The opposite would be plus 7. That makes both of them go away. And again, that equal sign is a law. What you do to one side, you have to do to the other side. So we're going to add 7. And 9 plus 7 is 16. The x is all by itself, and there's our answer. Just like we had to deal with positive numbers, what if we have a negative number? And just like with positives, the plus sign and the positive sign look exactly the same. Well, the minus sign and the negative sign also look exactly the same. Therefore, to get rid of a negative, you're going to add. Remember I told you you could write that down to kind of remember that? So if we're dealing with a negative, the opposite is either a positive or addition. So an example of this could be right here. We have negative 2 plus n. Again, our goal is to get the n by itself. Don't lose track of that. Now, what's keeping the n from being by itself? This negative 2 right there. What's the opposite of negative? Positive or addition. So I'm going to add 2. That goes away. Now I'm left with plus n, which is the same thing as positive n. And again, if you have positive anything, you can just drop that off. So we can just drop off that plus sign and we're left with n by itself. 6 plus 2 is 8. Therefore, the answer is 8. What about multiplication? Now you'll notice that I'm not writing multiplication like this. There's a reason for that. Now we're getting into algebra. We don't want to have this x up here representing multiplication when it could also represent a variable. So I'm going to use a different notation. I'm going to use this little dot right here to represent multiplication. So what I'm saying here is h times 5 is equal to 20. Well, just like addition and subtraction were opposites, multiplication and division are opposites. So if I want to get rid of a times 5, the opposite would be dividing by 5. Because again, what if I had 10 times 2 is 20, then I turned around and divided by 2, I end up back with 10. So what I started with is what I end up with. That makes those two opposites. So the opposite of multiplication is division. So to get rid of a multiply by 5, I'm going to divide. Now that's gone. What you do to one side, you do to the other, because again, that's a law. You can't break laws. 20 divided by 5 is 4. Therefore, the answer is 4. Now, if you saw this, you have to understand what that means. When you have a number and a variable just sitting next to each other, kind of like right here, that means multiplied. Anytime there's a number or variable smashed together, whether it's a combination of variables like x and y, that's x times y, or if it's a number and variable combo together, 2b, both of those mean multiplication. So 10k is the same thing as saying k times 10 or 10 times k. You have to remember that, because if you see that on the test, you're going to have to know, oh, that's multiplying by 10. The opposite would be dividing by 10. So what could that look like? Right here. This is read as 15g, but it means 15 times g. So what's the opposite of multiplication? Division. So we're multiplying by 15. Opposite is dividing. That cancels each other out. But again, this is a law. What you do to one side, you do to the other. 60 divided by 15 is 4, so the answer must be 4. Because remember, when we get rid of that 15, the g is now all by itself, which is our goal. Division. We've talked about addition, subtraction, multiplication. Now let's get into some division. Just like subtraction was the opposite of addition, division is the opposite of multiplication. So we have r divided by 6 is equal to 11. Now, to get rid of division, we do the opposite, which is multiplication. So to get rid of divide by 6, we times 6. Those two things go away. What we do to one side, we do to the other because of the law that's in place, which is that equal sign. So 11 times 6 is 66. There's our final answer. Now, just like with multiplication, there was a special way of seeing it. There's a special way of seeing division, too, instead of it being just written just like this, right here. Kind of looks like a fraction, kind of looks like a ratio, but in this case, it's representing division. Think of it like this. A fraction is a frozen division problem. So whenever you see a fraction, it doubles as a division problem. So this may be w over 9 as a fraction, but what we're reading it this time is w divided by 9. They are exactly the same. So if you see this, it could mean division. What could that look like? Right here. Again, that could be read as v over negative 7 as a fraction, but in this case, we're treating it like a division problem. What's the opposite of dividing by 7? Multiplying by 7. Here we got some more notation here. I told you we weren't using that for multiplication. We were going to use this. I can also use parentheses to represent multiplication, which is what I'm doing right here. So I'm dividing by negative 7. The opposite is multiplying. That means those two are now gone. But again, there's a law. What you do to one side, you do to the other. 11 times negative 7 is negative 77. There's your final answer. Now, that first part may have been a refresher for you, knowing that addition and subtraction are opposites, multiplication and division, but now we're getting into a little bit more meaty area when it comes to algebra. First thing you have to understand is how roots and exponents work. Remember, exponents are powers. And what does a power look like? It's that little bitty number that's right next to a bigger number or a bigger variable. So we could have 2 to the third power, 2 to the third, or we can have x to the fourth power. These little numbers are what we mean when we say powers. Well, a root is when we have a number in front of what you normally understand to be a square root. So this is not a square root. We now call this a fifth root. Now, we need to understand how these two things relate to each other. What it boils down to is, if you have a root, that's the same thing as having an exponent with that root number on the bottom. That is something usually better shown than explained, so here's a few examples. If you have the fifth root of x, which is how this is read, that's the same thing as having x and then a 1 over 5 exponent or power. You have a seventh root, that's the same thing as having 1 over 7 is a power. Fourth root, 1 over 4. Third root, 1 over third. See, it's better shown than explained. Those words I may have been saying may have confused you, but this should make it make a little more sense. Just like addition and subtraction cancel each other out, and multiplication and division, powers and roots cancel each other out. So right here, we have a fourth root. Well, if I turn around and take that thing to the fourth power, guess what happens? These two things go away, and I'm left with just x. They cancel each other out. Think of it like this. Let's say I have 7 squared. 7 squared, that little 2 means I'm going to use that 7 twice. 2 means twice. 7 is what I use. So 7 times 7 is 49. Okay? Well, if I try and take a square root, square root means what number times itself will give me what's underneath it. So the question is, what number can I multiply by itself to get 49? That just so happens to be 7. So they're reverse of each other. They cancel each other out. And some of you may be saying, well, wait a second. You just said if it's a fourth root, take it to the fourth power. Well, that's a squared. Where's the 2? Well, when you have a square root, there's a 2 there you don't see. We kind of erase it, kind of like when we have x over 1, we say, oh, we don't need that 1. Or if we have 1b, we kind of erase that 1 also. That 2 is not needed to be there. It's understood to be there. But the moral of the story is if you have a root, The opposite would be taking the same power of what that root is. So fourth root, fourth power, they cancel each other out. Eighth power, eighth root, guess what happens there also? They cancel each other out. And again, you're left with just x. Something else we have to understand. When you have a power of 1, so if I had 3 squared, that means 3 times 3. Because again, the big number is what you use. The little number or power is how many times you use it. So I'm going to use the 3 2 times, which means 3 times 3, which is 9. Well, if I had 3 to the first power, that means I'm going to use that 3 only once. Since I'm not multiplying it by anything, it just stays itself. Here are a couple more examples. U to the first power is just U. 7 to the first power is just 7. Now, we talked about how roots. If you have a fifth root of y, that's the same thing as y to the 1/5. Great. Well, what if you have just a normal power, n to the sixth? Can we rewrite that a different way? And the answer is yes. Just like when you have a number by itself, you can put it over 1. Exponents work the same way. If I have the 6 up there as a power all by itself, I can take that and put it over 1. Same thing. This is the same thing as that. This is the same thing as that. Keep that in the back of your mind. Now we're getting into why do powers and roots cancel each other out? Okay, just addition and subtraction made some sense. Multiplication and division made some sense. But these new terms, maybe they don't make a whole lot of sense to you. Well, if we have the fifth root of q, that's the same thing as q to the 1/5. If we have the fifth root, that's the same thing as 5 over 1. So if we have the fifth root of q, that's the same thing as q to the 1/5. Follow me so far? And I told you that to get rid of a root, you take it to the exact same power. So if I was going to get rid of a fifth root of q, I'd have to take it to the fifth power. What that boils down to is I am taking that 1/5 and multiplying it by 5. Well, if you know, understand your fractions pretty well, what happens when you have 1/5 times 5? 1 times 5 is 5. There's an understood 1 there, and 5 times 1 is 5. Same number on top, same number on bottom, you get 1. So the moral of the story of what's going on here. Fifth root of q becomes 1/5. You multiply it by 5 right here. We end up with 5 over 5. Great. That becomes just a 1. And as we've talked about, anything to the first power is just itself. Same thing works here. H to the third power, we're taking the third root, same thing as 1/3. Multiply 3 and 1/3, you end up with 3 over 3, which then again gives you 1, and leaves the H all by its lonesome. It's not so important that you understand the mechanics of why it works, so if this confuses you a little bit, it's okay. As long as you can get the gist of whatever the number power is, take it to that, whatever the number root is, I'm sorry, take it to the same power to get rid of it. Whatever the power is, take it to the same root. Now, what happens if there's more than one thing to cancel out? So kind of like in the beginning, I gave you an example problem that looked a little bit like this. It's not as simple as, okay, well, let's get rid of the 3 and let's get rid of the 7. Because there's two things to get rid of now, the 3 and the 7. And you can't just pick which one you feel like getting rid of. There's an order to what happens. That order is you get rid of what's farthest away first. Easier said than done. How do you know what's farthest away, and what do I mean by that? Well, if we have this problem right here, remember our goal, get the variable by itself. That's always your goal when you're solving an algebra problem that looks like this. So I want to get this x all by its lonesome. It's not by itself because there's a 2 and a 1 that's in the way. Now, we know we have to get rid of them, and you may be able to even recognize that you're going to have to divide by 2 and subtract 1. But which one do I get rid of first? Again, you get rid of what's farthest away first. So farthest first. So let's look at the x. The 2 and the 1, which number looks like it's farthest away? The 2 is right next to the x. The 1's farther away. So I'm going to get rid of this one first. And what's the opposite of plus 1? Minus 1. And what you do to one side, you do to the other. So plus 1 minus 1 goes away. Equal sign means do it to both sides. 3 minus 1 is 2. So again, we're getting rid of the 1 because it's farthest away. The opposite of plus is minus. Due to one side, due to the other. This is now gone. We're just left with 2x, and 3 minus 1 is 2. Now this is a simple one-step problem like we've already been doing. The opposite of multiplying by 2 is division. Do it to one side, do it to the other. 2 divided by 2 is 1. So x is equal to 1. Now, we have to talk about parentheses. Parentheses almost change the order in how you do something. But think of it like this. Parentheses is kind of like a house. You are closer to anybody inside that house than you are to anybody on the outside. For example, if I'm standing right next to a wall, let's say there's a person on the other side of that wall, I would have to go outside my door and go all the way around the house to get back to them. I can't just go straight through that wall. So looking at it, it's like I'm really close to them, but really I'm not. There's a whole path I have to go to get to them. But really, the person upstairs in the house is a lot closer. Would you rather just walk up the stairs or go outside the house and walk all the way around it? So even if the person looks like it's closer to you, in reality, the person upstairs is closer. That'll make more sense once we actually look at an example of what I'm talking about. Right here, we want to get the h all by itself. Hopefully we got that in tow already. There are 3 things in the way, 8, 3, and 10. It's obvious that 3 is the closest. And since we know we're taking care of what's farthest away first, 3 we're going to save for last. But the issue is, which one's closer, the 8 or the 10? We know we're getting rid of what's farthest away first, so which one is it going to be? Like I said, parentheses is kind of like a house. Anything inside that house is closer than anything on the outside. This 10 is on the outside of our parentheses. Therefore, it's farther away than the 8 because the 8's inside the house. So we're getting rid of this 8. Get rid of the 10 first because it's farthest away. The opposite of dividing by 10 is multiplying. What you do to one side, you do to the other. This is now gone, and 2 times 10 is 20. And I'm still left with my house. Now the question is, am I getting rid of the 8 or the 3? You may have noticed that the parentheses disappeared. Well, if you have something that's in parentheses, so everything on one side of the equal sign is in parentheses, you can get rid of it. So this whole thing over here is in parentheses, we can erase them. And now they're gone. So now we have 8 plus 3/8 is equal to 20. We know the 3 is the closest, it's right next to it, so the 8 has to be the farthest away. What's the opposite of positive 8? Minus 8. Remember we talked about that whole positive and addition are kind of the same, subtraction and negative are kind of the same. So the opposite of a plus or a positive 8 would be subtracting 8. Well, that's gone. Equal signs are law. 20 minus 8 is 12. Again, we talked about if you have a plus sign in front of something, same thing as a positive sign, don't have to have it. We understand that it's already positive. So we can just get rid of that and we're left with 3h. What's the opposite of timesing by 3? Dividing. Because remember, number, variable, smashed together means multiply. That's now gone. 12 divided by 3 is 4. Remember how we talked about a fraction is like a frozen division problem? Keep that in the back of your mind. But what if I have something like this? It kind of looks like a fraction, But again, in this case, we're thinking of it kind of like as division. It depends on what the question is asking for. You may have to treat it like a fraction. You may have to treat it like a division problem. But what we're talking about here is, where are some invisible parentheses at? It's understood that if you have a bunch of variables, numbers on top of a fraction or on bottom, all of those are going to be in parentheses. So for example, we have 2x plus 3. All that's on top of the fraction, which means it's all inside its own little parentheses, just like that. Just another way of writing it. Where that comes into play, though, is right here. When you're looking at a root, there's also a parenthesis underneath that. So, not looking at this complicated problem yet, what if we had this? The square root, which again, do we have to have that 2 there? No, it's understood to be there. So the square root of x plus 2. All of that is inside its own little parentheses, even if you don't see it. So right here, we have the third root. Don't worry about these pieces right now. We're not worried about those. We're just focusing on this. If we have the third root of that whole stuff, all of that is going to be inside its own little house, its own little parentheses. So all of this becomes this right here. It's just a restructuring of what you're already looking at. It's nothing new. You're not adding anything. You're just restructuring it. Now, where is that going to come in handy? Well, here's an example high set problem that you could possibly see on the test. So if you want to take a moment to try to do this, pause the video and try it. You're just trying to solve for that x. All right, first step. We have to put in any invisible parentheses that may be there. Just kind of keep us on track. Well, there's a root here. And just like we said, the top or bottom of a fraction is in a parenthesis, so is a root. So all of this right here has to be in its own little parenthesis. So the first step is just to restructure that problem so it makes more sense to us. Next step is to just start getting rid of what's farthest away. Well, there's a lot going on here, but just do it step by step and it won't be that bad. You're trying to get the x by itself. Note the numbers that are in the way. There's one here, there's one there, another one, and another one. There are four numbers that's in the way of that x being by itself. That tells me I'm going to have to do four steps to get to the final answer. First step, what's farthest away? Well, the 7's right next to the x. That's not farthest away. 11's inside the house, so that's not farthest away. That 5 is closer to the x than that negative 5. So therefore, this is the first thing I get rid of. What's the opposite of negative 5? Again, negative, subtraction, same thing in mathematical terms. So the opposite of negative would also be addition. So negative 5 plus 5 goes away. But what you do to one side, you have to do to the other side. So we're going to do this negative 3 plus 5. Just because all this is going on, don't forget about that law. What you do to one side, you do to the other. Negative 3 plus 5, you're $3 in the hole. You owe the bank $3. You hand them 5. 3 of that 5 takes you back to square, but you gave them an extra $2. Therefore, your bank account is now over 2. So now we're starting with this on the next page. Next step. Again, if you have to do this every step of the way, do it. Say, okay, there's my variable. What numbers am I getting rid of? In this case, now all I have left is a 7, 11, and that 5. So we're asking ourselves, which of those numbers is farthest away? The 7's right next to it, and again, 11's inside the house, 5's on the outside. Anything inside the house is closer than anything on the outside. So both of these are the closest to the x, so this must be what we're getting rid of. Again, think back to what we already talked about. The opposite of a root is taking that root and take it to the exact same power. So if it's a third root, you take it to the third power to make it go away. In this case, though, we're looking at a fifth root. How do we get rid of a fifth root? We take it to a fifth power. This gets rid of all of this. But again, what you do to one side, you have to do to the other. Don't forget that step. Many students tend to forget that step because they're so focused on doing the hard stuff, they mess up on the easy stuff. So if we're taking this to the fifth power, we also take the 2 to the fifth power. What is that telling us to do? Don't forget, when you're dealing with powers, the big number, which we call the base, is your what? It's what you're using. The little number, which we call the exponent or the power, is your how many. So the big number base is your what, the little number or power is your how many. Big number tells you what to use, the little number tells you how many times to use it. So I'm going to use that 2 5 times, which would be 2 times 2 times 2 times 2 times 2. 2 times 2 is 4, times 2 is 8, times 2 is 16, times 2 is 32. Again, once we got rid of that, we're left with everything over here in parentheses. Some students get confused when that disappears. I could have written it with parentheses there, but I don't have to. Because if everything on one side of the equal sign is in parentheses, you can just erase it. So this is really what we're working with, but we don't have to have that there. So now we're left with that. Again, if you want to keep yourself focused, again, say, okay, there's my variable. What number is farthest away? 7's right next to it. That 11's farthest away. Opposite of a plus 11 is minus. What you do to one side, you do to the other because of the equal sign. 32 minus 11 is 21. Now we're left with 7x is equal to 21. Again, number, variable, smashed together means multiply. Opposite is division. And again, I'm not writing it like this because that's the middle school way of writing division. We want to write it the algebraic or high school way. And that is written just like this, our frozen fraction. So 7 divided by 7 goes away, disappears, and 21 divided by 7 is 3. The x is now by itself. We now have a number answer, therefore our answer is 3. Now, we started at the beginning and talked about what opposites were. That's a good place to start with this kind of lesson. And then we built. We said, okay, well, what if we were doing addition? We were do subtraction. If we were multiplying, the opposite would be division. That should have been pretty much a review. And then we started diving into exponents and roots, which should have been a new concept almost. We talked about how if you're taking a power, like a power of 3, the opposite would be a root of 3. Or if you had a root of 7, the opposite would be a power of 7. Powers and roots cancel each other out. And we talked about take care of what's farthest away first. That's easy unless you're talking about parentheses. Take care of everything outside the parentheses before you take care of what's inside.